Hello everybody. So you might remember that earlier this year, back in May of 2021, there was a big volcanic eruption of Nyiragongo in DRC, Democratic Republic of Congo. So in Rwanda, in northern Rwanda, you've got the city of Gisenyi, and then just over the border you have Goma, where the volcano was. And I was sitting at home in Kigali watching the news of refugees coming across the border from Goma into Rwanda seeking refuge and safety from the lava. Now, I did three videos over the space of about 4 days, so watching the news breaking, and then for a few days, about a week after the volcano erupted, we had many earthquake tremors, which were strong enough to be felt down in Kigali, and they were happening, you know, every couple of hours throughout the day. And then I did a third video a couple of days later when things were starting to calm down a bit. So now everything's sort of back to normal, except people say that there's no lava in the crater anymore. But we don't have the shakes or the tremors anymore. Now, I recorded all of these as they were happening on another channel that I had, and I'm now closing down that channel, and I want to move everything over to this one. But the problem that I have is that YouTube doesn't allow you to merge or integrate different YouTube channels that you have. So I have to manually re-upload that video to this channel. And then it doesn't allow me to date when it was recorded. So there's no way for me to put it on the timeline in the order of the days that it was recorded. So once you upload something to YouTube again, it treats it like a brand new video that's just happened, which is kind of annoying, but you know, that's the way it works. So what I decided to do is, instead of re-uploading each of these videos, I've collected them all together as one. And I've put timestamps below so you can just jump to whichever video you want to watch. And I really just thought, you know, I'd just collect them together and keep them on here as a record for posterity. So I don't know if they're of interest or helpful to anybody in the future, but I thought I'd do that rather than delete them. Hi, so it's about 10 to 10 at night. This is a non-writing related post. I've just got off a Zoom call with my friends Harris and Rob in Brussels, and was just checking Facebook before I go to bed, and my friend Solvay had posted about the volcano erupting in Goma. Nyiragongo has erupted again. It lasted that in 2002. I wasn't in the country at that time. The official figures say around 100 people died and around between 200 and 400,000 people were evacuated. Other people have put that higher, I'll show you in a moment. But I just wanted to say, if you're religious, pray. If you're not, please send thoughts, because this is, you know, it's an awful thing. Many people will lose their homes. There are also, I visited the refugee camps in DRC, and many of those are already struggling. And when you go over to DRC, you see black lumps of black volcanic rock everywhere. People make their houses, their walls out of it. And that was from the last eruption, because all it leaves behind is a lot of destruction and a lot of rock. And so I'm just going to show you now some of the coverage coming in. So this is a picture from 2015 when I visited the refugee camps in Goma. And this is a picture. I'm on my way into DRC at this point, so we've skirted through the back of Goma. This is what Nyiragongo looks like on a good day. This is what it looks like when it's not erupting. It's basically a giant cloud factory in Goma. Now, if you go to Gisenyi on a clear day, you can stand on the high street in Gisenyi and you look down the road and you see Nyiragongo staring back at you from the end of the road. So this Nyiragongo from Gisenyi, from the Rwandan side of the border. The previous picture was from actually in DRC.
So these pictures are from 2 years ago, back in 2019. I did what a lot of people do. I went with my two friends, Samir and Ian, and we drove out to Gisenyi, near Gisenyi Airport. There's a big car park, and you can look out from there at the volcano in DRC at Nyiragongo. And it's a fun thing to do. These pictures are not erupting. These are just pictures of how Nyiragongo is usually. On a clear night, you can't see it if it's cloudy, but on a clear night, you just sit out in the car park and you look up at the sky, and the sky is blood red, and there's a volcano, and you see this light just sitting up there in the sky. Of course, what's happening at the moment is very different. So, I mean, you can imagine I got off my Zoom call, and the first thing that I see is my friend Solveig posting that Nyiragongo is erupting. My reaction to that was literally, what now? What when? Now? And yes, now. So, if we take a little look at what's happening on Twitter at the moment, hashtag Nyiragongo. We can see a lot of footage coming in. I said the official kind of count was 100 dead in 2002, around 400,000 displaced. GMP Division seems to be saying that last time it was 294 people died, 120,000 homeless. There's a lot of people up there. This is a major event. And the big concern, always the big fear, is that Nyiragongo sits at the top of Lake Kivu, and Lake Kivu is one of the world's three exploding lakes. So every 1,000 years or so, it's supposed to have a limnic eruption, which means that the lake turns over and releases a massive amount of CO2 gas into the atmosphere, and that can kill hundreds of thousands of people. If you've never heard of that before, Google Lake Nyos in Cameroon, because that was one of the greatest limnic eruption disasters that ever happened. Is the lake overturned in the night, and it killed almost 2,000 people and 3,500 livestock. Now, Lake Kivu in Rwanda is about 17 times bigger than Lake Nyos, so you can imagine that if a volcanic eruption set off the limnic eruption, then there would be a huge problem. I think we would have known if that was about to happen, so I don't think that's an issue at the moment, but it's always a concern that a volcanic eruption could trigger the lake to overturn. For now, though, I'm just looking at Twitter and watching what's going on. I'm seeing the pictures that are coming through are, I mean, they're incredible. You're looking at nature doing what nature does, and it's utterly incredible and utterly terrifying, both at the same time. And we're just hoping that the people that you're seeing are going to be safe, that they're going to have somewhere to go, that their homes are going to survive this. And that they're going to get out of there. Mean, obviously, we're all just watching what's going on, sharing messages on WhatsApp, checking that our friends are okay and that our friends' families are okay.
Sasa watu hakuna namuna, watu wote wanakimbia volkano ile inawaka kule Rouge, inashuka inaanza kuteremka upande wa watu. Sasa ndio watu wale bado wanavuka Rwanda, tujue tuende wapi, tunahitaji msaada.
So as my neighbor said, that's people basically escaping to safety in Rwanda. And so all I'm basically saying is, if anything comes up that allows you to donate or allows you to send any form of support, please do. Because you can just imagine it, can't you? You wake up thinking it's going to be another normal day, and at the end of that day, you've got your kids on your back and you're running to escape a flaming inferno. So we don't know what the damage is yet. It's too early to say. This has only been going on for an hour or so now. But please watch the news. Please keep watching.
Hi. So I thought I'd give a little bit of an update. I'm sitting here in Kigali, and it's been 2 days since Nyiragongo blew up. If I can get the hang of cards, then you should be able to see my initial reaction to that. But the past couple of days have been a little bit strange, and I wanted to explain what's been going on here. I'm delivering this in the dark, not because of electricity cuts or anything, but just because my bar lighting flickers really badly in front of the camera, so I turned it off. So the day after it happened, after the initial eruption, we had quite a few tremors that could be felt down here in Kigali. Now, I guess I need to look this up. Maybe the image will tell you something different. I'm guessing that we're roughly about 60 miles from the border in a straight line. So maybe I guess around 65, 70 miles from the actual volcano itself. So we're at a really good distance from that. And Nyiragongo, I think, is the largest active lava lake in the world. And because of that, it's very open at the top. So it's not like Pompeii, it's not a Vesuvius where it kind of spurts rock and everything into the sky that then buries everything. We, as far as I've noticed, there isn't any dust falling down here yet. I don't know if there will be. But what happens is that the lava comes up and then it flows over the side and then it destroys everything that it touches on the way down. Now, we do have earthquakes in this region. It's kind of a seismic area. I've been living here on and off for about 13, 14 years, and it happens, you know. The last big earthquake was back in 2008, and that was in Bukavu, which is on the southern border with Rwanda. And this is happening on the northern border of Rwanda, opposite Gisenyi-Rubavu. Now, in case you don't know, it can get a bit confusing when we're talking about the geography, because most towns in Rwanda have two names. They have the names that they're known by now, which are taken from older names for the region that the town is in. But they also have names that are more recent that have been rejected since 94, since the genocide happened. So for example, today we know Hue, we know Kironge, and we know Rubavu, but those places are also known by their kind of more recent names of Butare, Kibuye, and Giseni. So if I might say Rubavu, I might say Giseni, same place. So Giseni is on the Rwandan side of the border, and Goma is about 4 or 5 miles opposite it on the DRC side, and that is where the volcano is. And what's been a little bit strange is, so after an eruption or after a big earthquake, you would expect there to be a few little tremors, a few little aftershocks after that. Not a big deal. And that's kind of how it seemed to be going, because yesterday was pretty quiet. There were a few little wobbles, but, you know, it was pretty quiet. But then today, it's been very strange. There was a registered 4.7 magnitude earthquake at about 11 o'clock this morning. And I woke up quite late today. I guess I woke up maybe around 10:30. I was quite tired. I lay in. And since I woke up, the world has been doing this pretty much every half an hour to 2 hours throughout the day. And there's some different reports coming in, because the website that I usually check what's going on said that the highest rated one was 4.7 today, but I have seen others reporting 5 magnitude today. So I don't know if they're actually rounding that up,
or if the two sites are recording different data. I'm not too sure. But all I can say is it's been a wobbly day in Kigali. I mean, you know, we're going to make a cup of tea, going to the fridge. I'm laughing about it, but it is actually quite disturbing. There's a couple of great articles, and I'll put all links to things that I talk about below. But one of them that came out a few hours ago was saying that scientists don't yet know what's causing this seismic shifting, because usually, like I say, you'd have a big earthquake and then you'd have smaller ones and they'd go quiet. But today it's been all over the place. Like, you'll have a little wobble, then you'll have a big wobble, then you'll have a little wobble and a big wobble. So yeah, we've sort of been all over the place today. It's been really unpredictable. And what that article is saying is basically that it could just be that the land is just relaxing, is just settling back down after the eruption. But it's also saying that it could be indicative of magma flowing underneath the ground towards the volcano, and that potentially there could be another eruption. So we don't know, and apparently at the moment nobody really knows. Now, a few other concerns have been raised about Lake Kivu. Now, in my original video, I did mention, and there's a very, very good article below, that Lake Kivu is one of the world's three exploding lakes, and it's by far the biggest. And what that means is that volcanic gases, CO2 in particular, methane and CO2, build up in this lake. And for Lake Kivu, it's suggested that once every 1,000 years, the lake turns over in what is called a limnic eruption, and it releases the CO2, and that would kill or suffocate many hundreds of thousands of people, livestock. I did mention in the last video Lake Nyos. Now, the fear has always been that if Nyiragongo, that a volcanic eruption could trigger the limnic eruption. And every time, so when Nyiragongo blows, as it did in 2002, or when we have a big earthquake, like we did in 2008, there is always that fear. And people in Kigali, we look at each other and there's a bit of a nervous kind of, do hope that the lake's okay, you know? We make nervous jokes because it is at the back of your mind occasionally that is potentially a very nasty disaster. Now, there has been a video that has been circulating online, which is reported to be somebody videoing a gas bubble trapped in Lake Kivu. Now, it's kind of a difficult one because nobody seems to be able to track down who took that, exactly where they took it, or when they took it. It's been circulating since early afternoon today. So if it was the start of a limnic eruption, I think we would have heard about that by now. So I don't know, maybe it's a trick of the air on the water, or maybe it is actually a gas bubble trapped underneath the water. And there have always been stories about this. And a few years ago, somebody told me a story, and I don't know if it's true or if it's a folk story, if it's kind of like an urban legend. But the story was that there was a giant gas bubble trapped underneath the water in Lake Kivu, and that two divers accidentally swam into it, got trapped in there and suffocated. And again, I don't know if that's actually a true story or if it's a sort of a folk myth. But it is known that large bubbles of gas do get trapped down there in the lake. So potentially it's true. Now, one of the things we've got to be careful is not to kind of add panic to what is already a major disaster. I mean, people have lost their homes, people are fleeing. Latest figures are about 4,000 people have crossed into Rwanda. They're being given emergency shelter and food. And, you know, that is already a major humanitarian disaster. And what you don't want to do is then to speculate about how much worse it could get. But it is always at the back of people's minds. We know that the lake is potentially full of lethal gas, and that a tremor or a hard knock could cause that gas to be released, and something similar to Lake Nyos could happen. We don't know. And there are some interesting figures in the article below about the saturation levels of gas in the lake, and that they have been rising over the past few decades, and that potentially it is about ready to turn over. But at the same time, I think it was sometime back in maybe 2006, let me find the article. So yeah, sometime back in 2006 roundabout, there was a natural occurrence called whitening of the lake, where Lake Kivu basically within a couple of days turned completely bright blue, some people say turquoise. Now I didn't see that, but you could imagine that, you know, that you're living next to a potentially lethal lake, and all of a sudden overnight it completely changes colour. You could imagine people were feeling quite panicked by that. Friends who were in that area at that time did say, you know, people were not comfortable with this. But at the same time, that turned out just to be a very normal natural phenomenon, and it didn't lead to any loss of life. So again, when we're looking at pictures like this video that's circulating, we need to be a little bit careful, because we don't know who took that. We don't know where they were. We don't even really know that it was taken today, or, you know, and we don't actually, we can't verify that that is gas rising in the lake. And like I say, it's been circulating since early afternoon. So if that was dangerous, we probably would have heard about it by now. We don't know. And that's the thing at the moment. There's just a huge amount of uncertainty. And, you know, we're all checking on our friends up there and our families around, just checking that people are okay. And at the moment, that's all we can do. And I have to be, thankfully, I can report that for the past, at least the past 4 hours now, it's been really, really silent. These big tremors don't seem to have continued. They seem to have stopped now. But having said that, yesterday was very, very calm, and then it started jiggling about early this morning. So really, that's just the thing. It's very uncertain at the moment, and all that we're doing, we're glued to Twitter. We're watching the hashtags Nyiragongo eruption, Rubavu and Goma, and just watching what, and Lake Kivu, of course, and watching what's coming in and what's going on. And at the moment, I think that's all we can do. So yeah, at the moment, everything here for me in Kigali is fine. And for the people that I know, they're safe at the moment. And we'll just see what the next few days bring. Hi, everybody. I thought I'd give a little update on the Nyiragongo situation. By situation, I mean the giant volcano that is currently erupting. There have been some interesting developments in the past few hours, at least since this morning. I was woken up quite early on by quite a strong tremor, and it does seem that we've had at least another 4.5 tremor sort of in the past 4 hours, and a lot of people are still reporting tremors. So there's a bit more activity this morning than there was yesterday. Now, just to disclose, I don't have a television or a radio, so like a lot of people, I'm getting the news from watching Twitter and watching the uploads that are going on there. I try to follow on Google News, but what I noticed from that is, you know, it's very rare, it doesn't update that frequently. And I think really for a lot of people, that's the frustration, and that's what's a little bit annoying, is you know that if this was happening in the UK or this was happening in America, there would be 24-hour rolling coverage updates on every website. But really, I think Twitter is the main one for us, because people on the ground are uploading what's going on. So perhaps the biggest development this morning has been that the government in Goma has issued a mass evacuation notice. So huge areas of Goma are currently being evacuated towards Saki, which is towards the south of Goma. Now, again, I'm definitely not the place to get your official news from. I'm just somebody sitting here watching this happen. And from what I've been seeing, one of the reasons that's being given for this evacuation is that last night they took video footage of the crater in Nyiragongo, and they're seeing that the lava flow has, that it's empty. is what they seem to be reporting. Now, as a bystander, I thought, oh, good, you know, that's great. There's no lava in the crater. That means, you know, it's settled down. It'll take years to fill up. It'll be fine. Apparently, that isn't what that means. Apparently, what that means is that instead of a nice controlled release of lava over the top of the volcano at a speed you can probably outrun, it potentially signals, as I was talking about in the last video, that lava is moving around underneath Goma. Potentially, it's looking for a way out. And of course, if it's not coming up and over the top of the volcano in a nice controlled way, then that could suggest a potentially explosive release of magma somewhere else in the city. And of course, what everybody is hoping is that that release point will not be in the lake, which would then potentially trigger the limnic eruption that I was talking about in the previous video. There is a news report coming out from Twitter from France, from the French news channels, that the army and the military personnel helping with to manage the disaster zone in Goma are also concerned that it could possibly another tremor could possibly disrupt the lake and release noxious gases. Now, one thing that I absolutely love about Google, thank you so much Google, is that they now also translate Kinyarwanda. And my Kinyarwanda is very, very small. So to be able to translate local news into from Kinyarwanda to English is really incredible. And Google's translation services are so, so important and welcome. Now, I think, of course, this happening in the internet age is a kind of a double-edged sword, because if we didn't have the internet and we didn't have access to news 24/7, we probably wouldn't know that very much was going on here, and I think everybody would be a bit calmer. But at the same time, we're feeling the shudders here, especially people who are living in multi-story houses are getting quite nervous. I'm quite okay. I live in a single-story house, and my roof is pretty much made out of plywood. So I have considered that if this came down on me, likelihood is I could probably brush it off and walk out, which is not the case for many buildings, especially the shops up in Giseni. The same thing happened in Changugu in the wake of the 2008 earthquake, is a lot of the shops, they have pillars outside and they have concrete facades. And of course, once the cracks come, a strong wobble just causes that to fall down on whoever is standing beneath it. So, you know, there's a huge danger of people dying from infrastructure collapsing and roads collapsing. But for me, I'm fine. My friend lives in a multi-story house and she's quite worried. So, you know, having the internet means that when you feel that, you can actually check online, you can see if there's anything major happening. But it also means that we get all of the theories about, you know, there are people out there shouting, the lake is definitely going to overturn. And there's people say, there's definitely going to be another eruption. And we don't know. And this is what I said in the last thing. It's all a lot of uncertainty. So, I mean, I think it's important to speculate and to be aware that there are other dangers. But at the same point, there isn't really a plan for that. I mean, my mum asked, she said, do you have a contingency plan? And I was like, well, not really. I mean, the problem is that, I mean, there are about 2 million people in Goma. I mean, we're talking about a region, a vast region with millions of people in it. I mean, where would you go? There isn't really, I mean, there aren't enough planes or boats to carry people out. There's, you know, so hopefully, I'm aiming for the positive here. I think hopefully it will settle down, we'll be okay. Mid-range disaster, there will be a second eruption. Worst disaster, the lake turns over. So I don't know. I'm just thankful I'm okay at the moment, and keeping an eye on things and seeing what's happening. So I don't know if these updates are helpful or not. They're just really me blathering on about sitting here and watching it. So see what happens.